experiment on the study of the non-equilibrium dynamics of superconductors, some sort of summary of what we've done in the past few years in the field and where we are going. So acknowledgement of all the people in the group, and in particular Tristan and Kenny are the ones that have carried most of the experiment together with the postdoc Chris. So we are interested in studying the non-equilibrium phenomena in solids. When we start to talk about the non-equilibrium, what we usually mean is we take light and we can tune light at different wavelengths, and we excite the system, we drive the system into a non-equilibrium state, and then we watch the response of the system in this new non-equilibrium state. So I started by saying that our mean is to use light to drive the system outside of equilibrium, and if we look at the spectra of the electromagnetic spectra, as well as the spectra combined with the excitation that are known in solids, obviously depending from the wavelength of the light that you choose, you can end up in different regime. So you could end up in a regime where what you are doing is pretty much taking a quasi-particle from the ground state and bringing them in some excited state and watching the recombination dynamic. And so this would be what we are doing here. Or the other regime you could explore is a regime that we called an optically driven regime. It's a regime where now you can look at some particular excitation of the system. Let me think about the case of phonons, which is the easiest one to think about. And now you can tune the wavelength of the incoming light source at the exact the frequency of the mode you're interested in. And so what you're doing now, you're simply driving this optical regime. So I like to think of this by looking at a classical situation. And I think then we can extrapolate this classical situation to the regime that we look in terms of solid. So we all know the case of a pendulum. This works now. And we all know that if we want to study, this is a big challenge because the touch screen here doesn't really respond. Okay, so we all know that in a pendulum, you have, if you want to run the pendulum in this position, upside down is unstable. But now, if you come in and you tune the system with some frequency, then you see you can stabilize this. This position here. So you make this new position from being in a stable position to a stable position. So when you think about the situation for the pendulum, really what you're doing, you are creating a new region of stability, but you can think of the whole process in two ways. You can say you can study the process somewhere here, and this is what I call the dynamical regime, which means you take a pendulum, you let the pendulum go, and by studying the oscillation of the pendulum, you can learn about the system. Or what you can do, you can enter this new regime, which obviously is not a regime that is accessible in equilibrium, and is obviously not accessible near equilibrium. So we go from a near equilibrium regime to a completely new non-equilibrium regime. So what we can do with light today, we can pretty much span doing the analogous situation that we can do in a pendulum. So just looking at the pendulum swinging back and forth, or exciting this pendulum in this way and accessing this forbidden regime by using light. And so what we are doing in my group in Berkeley, pretty much we are taking all the systems that are known as a function of the interaction strength or the structure in topology, and we are exciting them in different regimes. So let me just, the two regimes that can be summarized here. So we are doing is in a regime in which we are so-called the near equilibrium. And so what we are doing, we are really looking at collective states that sometimes are, you know, hidden by another collective state. And we are applying this method to a lot of strongly correlated materials. And then what we are doing, we are looking at what we call this driven regime. So in particular, we are doing experiment now, looking at the iron selenide on top of the strontium titanate. And the purpose here, you come with mid-infrared light, you couple to a particular phonon of the substrate, and you study the response of the system. And we are doing this as well with the C60. In other regime we are exploring are in the case of Zunke. And so here, the idea is the same, but now you are tuning the light to see the band gap of the material, and you are creating this new state. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to actually focus mainly in this regime here. If there is time, maybe I'm going to talk about this other type of control regime, where we are creating some plasmon, and we are watching them recombining, and we are watching their momentum dynamics. So I'm going to pretty much focus in this regime here, and I'm going to, this is like the starting point. where we can go and what we can do with light in this regime and what we are learning for future experiments in this field. So far what we know that the majority of experiments done in the past 2 decades are experiments done by spectroscopy, such as optical spectroscopy, and the principle, and we heard the talk by Stefano before, and the principle is a very well-known principle by now. You come in with photon, and you are photon in, photon out technique. When you start to go into this non-equilibrium regime, instead of having simply a probe, now you have what we call a pump. So this acts as the means to drive the system away from equilibrium. And once the system is away from equilibrium with your pump, and obviously you can change the frequency of your pump, then you come in with a probe, usually in the UV regime, and through this probe then you can measure absorption of transmission from the system. This has been over the past 20 years applied and used a lot to study high-temperature superconductors, and in particular by looking at the reflectivity curve, the new information that the technique brings, you can look now at the change of reflectivity following a pump pulse. So this is telling you how the system has been excited, is coming back to the equilibrium state, and you can do as a function of time. So you can really look at the whole spectrum and the whole dynamics how the system goes back to equilibrium. So there have been plenty of study done in this field, some debate of what is the mechanism that governs this decay of quasi-particle. So when you look now at this part of the curve, the way this decay back to equilibrium, eventually you go back to negative time, which is equilibrium, so before the pump is coming in, the way this reflectivity goes back to equilibrium gives you information of the time scale associated with quasi-particle. So if you have a system where there are no interactions, you would excite it, right away will come back down to equilibrium. Depending the type of excitation and the type of interaction you have, obviously this decay time can be strongly affected and modified. And there's been several reports in the field. If we focus in the case of superconductivity, probably one of the main puzzling experiments has been the observation of a change of reflectivity when you scan the doping dependence of the phase diagram. This was an old experiment by the group of Justin in Berkeley. And the conclusion out of this experiment was that near optimal doping, you have a quantum critical point. We know that since then the field has evolved a lot, and actually there have been some experiments that have questioned whether what we are looking here really is the presence of a quantum critical point. So when we start to think about this, we realize that this technique is great because we really learned a lot and has added a lot to the equilibrium technique, but there is one question. So we know that if we would have a system that is isotropic, so basically some metal, take a conventional superconductor, you open up a gap, pretty much in the momentum space everything is isotropic, then you can go back and think of a tool like this one and say this will be a great way to learn about this recombination process. But now you can think of a system like this unconventional superconductor where when you are in the superconducting state as well as in the normal state or so-called pseudo-gap state, you know that you have an anisotropic gap. So in particular we know that we have a node, so here the gap is zero. As you move away from the gamma y direction, which is another direction, the gap will increase, eventually reaching its maximum here. And we learned from equilibrium probe that there is a lot, much more than simply drawing this D-way gap. There are probably 2 different gaps. There are competing orders. There are many things that equilibrium technique has a problem in revealing because what it looks like is that the time scales are quite similar. And so what the new approach we are going to take now is to actually shape the system outside of equilibrium and watch how the dynamic along this, the different momentum evolve. So the idea at this point is to learn from what optical spectroscopy has taught us in the past 20 years, but push this type of experiment to a new frontier which can access the different momentum region. Because obviously now you can think that if you excite quasi-particle here, well, they can decay back on in this channel here, because here there is a gap and they cannot decay back. And this obviously is a different situation if you will have an isotropic system. So what we have done in the past 5 years or so, we have extended the typical technique of photoemission now to be able to do pump and probe experiment. And I want to point out, this is not something we have done. I mean, there has been a lot of study and a different group have tried to push this technique to this frontier of time and the momentum resolved study. And in particular, the idea is you are coming in with a pump, and here the animation is not working, I apologize, but the idea is you come in with a pump, you create, you generate this non-equilibrium quasi-particle, they come back. So now when you think about the photoemission intensity, which is nothing else in very simple terms, measuring how many photoelectrons are reaching your analyzer, when you get this information, you get information on the spectral function. And now if you do your experiment by as a function of time, so you have first a pump and then you have a probe, now the spectral function is a function of momentum. Momentum is nothing else than the angle of emission of these photoelectrons, as a function of omega, which is the energy at which they are emitted, and now you also are adding time. So a typical photoemission spectra, which will be energy as a function of momentum, now you can look at this spectra and you can look at it as a function of time. So I will discuss about this type of experiment later on, but now what you can do, you start with a system that has a gap here, and by pumping the system, now you can close the gap and eventually look at the dynamics of reopening of this gap.
What is F then?
What's up?
What is F?
Oh, this is the Fermi function.
And it's not depending on time, that one?
It actually does depend on time, yes. Yeah. Thank you.
So in this case, it's hard to get. So what you are plotting, you take out F or not?
So in this case, I'm dividing by the Fermi function. In this particular case.
And you know what is.
Yes, because I can measure. Yes, but in some other case, I'll show later, I'm not dividing by the Fermi function. So here you see that I'm dividing by the Fermi function. And this is just, if you want, a real data, but it's a cartoon. You can see that we can see this state above the Fermi level, and this is because we are dividing from the Fermi function. So. The new thing, so I told you that there has been several attempts to apply this technique to study materials, but one of the real bottlenecks was the energy and the momentum resolution. So if we look at previous work, pretty much the energy and momentum resolution was by a factor of 10 worse than typical photoemission experiment. And so when you want to study system where you're dealing with gaps that are very small and very small energy scale, if your energy resolution is 300 millielectron volt, or your momentum resolution is 0.3 angstrom to the minus one, then you lose all the relevant information. So what we did is pretty much to redesign the way these experiments are done, and in particular redesign the way the pump is operating. So up to, I would say, really like probably 6-7 years ago, the idea was you use a laser light, you come in with as much energy you can, you dump this energy in your system, you drive the system outside of equilibrium, and you watch the dynamics. Which is a very good approach to use if you have a metal, if you have maybe a semiconductor, although we are learning now doing experiment there that actually is not always the best approach, but it's definitely not a good approach for superconductivity. Because when you come in with all this energy, what came out and what has somehow brought the field, I would say, to a wrong direction, was the fact that all the experiments that were published were saying we don't see any signal of superconductivity, time resolved photoemission is not going to be good to study this correlated material. And the problem there is that you start with the energy gap that are very small. So if you don't have a way to control the energy you are putting into your system, which obviously is related to the fluence of the light that you are using to pump the system, then you are automatically destroying everything, closing the gap, you're just studying a normal state. So what we did, we redesigned the system, and I won't go into detail, that allow us to control in a very fine way the amount of energy we are giving to the system. And this actually turned out to be really nice, because now I will show you later on just some experiment that is bringing us now to do some very interesting experiment when we can really control the amount, in this case of superconductivity, we are destroying in the system. And in other material, we can look at quasi-particle recombination in different regions in the momentum space. So it's opening really a new direction where the field can go. So now let me just discuss briefly some of the results on superconductors. And this is probably really the first work that we did and the first high-resolution work in this field. And I'm using this as starting point for further discussion. So here we are looking, if you want, at a boring thing. We are looking at nodal quasi-particles, so there is no gap, the superconducting gap is zero. For most studied material, BISCO2212, optimal doping. And so what we are looking here, a comparison between the equilibrium spectra, and so whenever you are going to see negative time, it means you are in equilibrium, and the transient spectra, meaning after the pump is coming in and excite the system. So by just looking at these data, raw data, normalization, nothing is done on them. So you can see the quality of the data is very nice. But the first surprising thing to us was to see, just by looking by eyes, is that here the color scale represents the intensity. Blue is maximum intensity, white is zero. And the surprising thing was to see that in this region, where we know that we have a very sharp peak, so where we have a coherent quasi-particle, the intensity is suppressed when you go in the transient state. So what we could do, what we did here, we plotted what we call the energy distribution curve. These are nothing else than intensity curve. What you are doing in this 2D image, now you are getting information on the intensity. So you fix a momentum, for example here, this is the Fermi momentum. You fix the momentum and you come down in energy. So when you do this, you will see zero. You are above the Fermi level. There are no emitted photoelectrons for the way the technique works. Now here you're going to have a peak, and then this peak will die off, and then here again zero. And so this is exactly what you would see here. You come, you have zero intensity, no electric photoelectron coming out. Now you cross the Fermi momentum, this point here, there is a peak, and then eventually the intensity goes down. So what was beautiful to me when we did this first experiment, which demonstrated as an experimentalist, maybe who is not familiar with the technique will not appreciate it, but usually having information about the intensity is a pain in this type of experiment. And here, without doing anything, normalization, you see that the spectra are exactly one on top of the other. And this is something that you will not even achieve if you are simply hitting the system. This is a problem you constantly have. And that's why there has been very difficulty in extracting information on intensity. So this is very nice because it's clearly telling us that the moment we are pumping the system, so driving outside of equilibrium, you see that the main change is always confined in this region where there is a coherent quasi-particle peak. As long as the peak disappears, or put it in other words, as long as the peak passes this dashed line here, which is this particular energy here, you see that the effect is almost gone. Another way of looking at the data is to take the difference in intensity, and you plot the different intensity as a function of energy. And so what you see here, now here you are looking at state above the Fermi level. So you are seeing the state above here, and you see that there is now a small difference in this tail. So you have to zoom in to see, which is what we are doing here. So what you see when you take the difference, you see that you are gaining spectral weight. Gaining spectral weight means that you are exciting electron, quasi-particle, and you are bringing them, you are populating a state that is an excited state. And that's what above the Fermi level, that's what we are seeing here, okay? And then what you see here, negative intensity, is what we call suppression of spectral weight, which means that the intensity going from here to here is decreasing. And so what this is telling you, we see that we have state, we have intensity gained above the Fermi level, and suppression, and then pretty much from this energy on zero. I'll talk later on about this energy. This energy is important because this is the famous energy where there is a kink in the dispersion, and where there's been a lot of work in demonstrating that this is due to the interaction with the lattice. So what this is telling us is that this particular energy scale is playing a very important role in describing the dynamics of the system, because it's like really acting as a very sharp cutoff. So what we can do at this point, and this is the first step trying to understand about dynamics and competing phase, is to start to look at, extract now new information, which are information as a function of time. So what we can do, we can take this spectra here, we can integrate and look at the evolution of the function of time, which is summarized here. So now we are looking at the change of intensity, so what I explained to you before. So this is, you know, in the equilibrium state, all of this is the transient state, and you see that this curve looks very similar to what I showed you before for reflectivity. So what this is telling you, this is measure intensity. This is telling you the moment your pump excites the system, there is all of a sudden a change in intensity, which is what I showed you before, and then eventually the system wants you come back to the equilibrium state. So this is the interesting part. This part here is the part where we can get information about what is going on. And in particular, we can learn how we are coming in with light, we are breaking Cooper pair, we can learn how this Cooper pair will recombine back together by extracting this time scale. So first thing we did here, we did an experiment as a function of fluence, which is nothing else the amount of energy we are delivering to the system. And you see that there is some small fluence dependence here, which at the beginning was surprising because it's a little bit in contrast to what the reflectivity experiment were measuring. It's observed a much bigger change. Eventually, we can extend this study. Now we have a momentum-dependent selectivity, which optical studies don't have. So we learn that every time we go outside the Fermi arc, this is where the intensity changes much more.
What is the energy of the photons?
The energy of?
The photons.
1.5 electron volt for the pump and 6 eV for the probe. So one thing that one would, you know, the obvious thing to think is to say, well, you know, whenever you are on the Fermi arc, here at the node, the gap is zero. As you move away from the node, you have a small gap. Here you have a big gap. This is why you are seeing a big change in the intensity as a function of the pump fluence. Eventually, I'll show you that this is actually not the case, so there is something else going on there. But so the important thing here, I mean, there are many takeaway messages, but for the purpose of where I want to go later, the important thing is to say that overall, this study seems to suggest that if we think about the bimolecular recombination, as explained by optical spectroscopy, this is fine. We can kind of think of the way, you know, this recombination is taking place. So the more quadriparticle you produce, the more they decay back, and you have some density dependence recombination rate. So we start again now to look at the property of the functional momentum, and what you can see is that clearly here, when you look at this curve at the node or away outside the Fermi arc, there is a difference. So the way you can look at this curve again, think about this curve giving information on how much time it takes to go back to zero. Zero is equilibrium. So this is telling that this region and this region, actually there is a clear difference in terms of time scale. And what we learn, this is not for this talk, but it's in the science paper, what we learn is that there is really a critical point here at the tip of the Fermi arc, where if you look at the decay rate, all of a sudden you have a huge change. So definitely we learn that there is one dynamic going on here, and the completely different dynamics going on here. So the other very interesting things is, so far I told you that we can describe this behavior. There is a momentum dependence, which we didn't know before. And if we think a previous study, what everything is saying is that there is what is called a bimolecular recombination, again, is a density-dependent type of decay rate, which is telling you the more thing you produce, you can even get information on the time. But what we found, actually, that there is something interesting that goes beyond this. In particular, so here, I'm showing you intensity curve, and the delta I, which is the change of intensity as I plotted here, and I'm showing now as a function of temperature. So what we are doing, pretty much, we are doing the experiment I showed you before at one particular temperature, and then we keep on changing the temperature and we do exactly the same experiment. So what we are asking is, when we look at this excited state, and we look at the change that the pumping is creating on this excited state, is there a difference at the function of temperature? We go across the superconducting and the pseudo gap temperature or not? Because we already learned that there is a very strong momentum dependence. So the next information we're going to get about the particular relation with the superconducting state. And what we found here that was very interesting is the fact that depending where you are sitting on this curve, actually, you get totally different information. In particular, we saw that if we are sitting somewhere here, so after this decay process has started, overall there is some sort of linear temperature dependence. But if we are sitting exactly here at T equals zero, so T equals zero is the moment the pump is coming in and is exciting the system, then you see that you have a totally different behavior. And so the interesting thing here is that the behavior we see here, we see that there is within the error bar some no big change at high energy, at high temperature, sorry, there is not a big change of intensity. And then there is a first small step when you hit this temperature, which for the moment we call the T star. Then again, it seems that nothing much is changing. So there is a first step, nothing changes. And then from this point on, it's like if there is a new temperature scale, where all of a sudden you see that there is this increase of intensity, and then you reach a maximum near TC, and then it comes down. So just looking at exactly T equals zero is a lot of information about all these other temperature scale, which you don't see if you go at 3 picoseconds, which is not far enough because I'm still here. So as you see, I'm still far away from equilibrium, but it looks really like there are two completely different dynamics at very short time scale, within 100, 150 femtoseconds, and time scale that start to go with the order of picosecond. And so what this is telling us, two important information, that if we really want to learn something about superconductivity, this star which eventually we measure for a different sample in this pseudograph, NTP, which we believe is the prepared temperature, and correspond with the Nernst effect, but this will be for another talk, but we can talk more if you're interested. So if you want to learn about these different phenomena, you need to be exactly here at T equals zero. So, and this is a point that has been totally, neglected so far. Everything has been focusing on this part here. So then what is so special about T equals zero? So here I'm plotting you now a zoom in of the data I showed you before. Delta E as a function of delay time. And so here I'm zooming in here, T equals zero. So when you look at the previous curve over this longer range here, well, you see that there is a peak. Maybe now that I show you some zoom in, you see that there is something going on, and this is what is going on. So if you would have a simple bimolecular recombination, so where again, the quasi-particle decay is related with the density, so the number of quasi-particles, then what the theory predicts, if you look at the density of quasi-particles as a function of delay time, this is nothing else than my delta I, then you would see that there is a maximum exactly the moment you are creating excited state and then decay down. Obviously, this is not what we see here. There is some delay. So something is missing in this formula to explain this particular superconducting state. So we need to take a step back, and eventually this is some very interesting physics going on. We need to take a step back and ask ourselves, if we look at the superconducting gap, what happened exactly at T equals zero? And so here, and probably these are not going to work, this movie, but I could try. So here I'm showing you data again for the same sample. There is somewhere on the Fermi arc, away from the nodal direction. These data are, as you can see, divided by the Fermi function, going back to you. And here you can see that there is a gap. These are the equilibrium spectra. The difference between these spectra is the fluence of my pump. Fluence, is, you can think of it as the amount of energy you are giving to the system. So this is what we call high pump fluence. So going back to what I told you at the beginning of the talk, all the studies done up to 5 years ago, what they were calling low pump fluence was 100 microjoules. So you can see how much lower we are, and we can go down all the way to really few microjoules for this coordination type of experiment. So now I can show you this movie. Let's see if it goes. Then you see that as a function of time, you are closing the superconducting gap, and then you can watch the way the gap opens back. And so there are tons of information, many of which we are still analyzing because we don't exactly understand what we are seeing. So today I'm going to focus on the most so-called boring aspect of what, in a conventional way we can fit and we can understand. But there is much, much more. And the reason I'm saying here, because I know there are a lot of very good theorists, and what this field is missing today is help from theorists. Because I know, because we talked a lot about it, we really need help from theorists to push what we are seeing beyond what we can do in a very simple way. So you see this, then you can go to the other part, then you can redo the experiment at lower fluence. Let's see if this works. No. Okay. A lower fluence, and you don't see the same effect. So this is just summarizing the data pretty much here. Let me stop this, otherwise we all get dizzy. I lost the mouse. Okay, so what I'm plotting here now, I show you that this gap closed as a function of time. Okay, so this one here represents one data point somewhere here for this particular study. So what I'm plotting here, obviously you see that there is a dynamic of the gap. So what I'm plotting here, I'm plotting the minimum gap that I can measure. So here the minimum gap is closing, it's going to be zero. So I'm plotting the minimum gap divided by the gap in equilibrium. Okay. So you see here that the gap is closing, so the minimum gap is going to be zero, and this is going to give me a data point, 23, so I'm somewhere here. Okay. So you see that I can do experiment in so-called high-fluence regime, and this type of experiment are completely closing the superconducting gap. So if I sit somewhere here, I'm studying one regime. I'm studying a regime where I come in, I completely break all quasi-particle, and then I can see how they recombine, and I can learn about this recombination process. If I come here, and this actually is turning to be very good for us to study competing phases, to understand what is going on away from the novel, from the Fermiarc. And then the other thing you can do here is that you can come now with very low pump fluence. The movie didn't work, but what you see is that if the pump fluence is